Until God opens the eyes and ears of men and women, they cannot hear the gospel. Welcome to Through the Bible. That's some of the wisdom our teacher, Dr. J. Vernon McGee, shares with us as we travel through the Old Testament book of Deuteronomy in chapters 29 and 30. I'm Steve Schwetz, and I'm so glad that you're here. Now, as we've been talking about, May is letter month, and that's a time that we set aside to share your letters and then to celebrate the work that God is doing through our study in His Word. You know, I got a couple of letters today that I want to share with you, but first let's listen to one that Dr. McGee read on the broadcast years ago.
Now, I want to share with you today a letter that came to us from Camas, Washington, and I'll be honest with you, I was a little shocked when I began to read it. Maybe you will be. But follow on through, because this lady has a real sense of humor, and I always like that, you know. This is the way it begins. I think the Federal Communications Commission should hear about you. After all, other products must bear their ingredients, that is, tell what's in them. And this should be true of radio preachers, too. I'd like to submit this warning label for Through the Bible Radio. Now listen to this. Warning. The program you're about to hear may be habit-forming. According to unsolicited comments from listeners, it may have a pronounced effect on your health, physically, mentally, and spiritually, for both now and throughout all eternity. The Surgeon General's office can't explain it, but thousands swear they are fed the bread of life via the radio waves each day. Be forewarned, the soul that is saved today may be your own. And you know, I like that. That's quite original as far as I know.
You know, Dr. McGee loved hearing from our listening family, and we still do today. So here's a couple more. First, we got a letter. This is from a listener of our Amharic broadcast in Ethiopia. Your broadcasts are a spiritual food that has helped me to grow in Christ. I use what I learn in preparation of sermons. I live in an area which is far from big cities. Because of this, Christian literature is scarce, and people are living in darkness. Please keep us in your prayers, because lots of people engage in demonic practices that have been passed down from one generation to the next. I will continue to tell more people about your broadcasts and pray that the Lord brings His light into their homes. Now, next we've got a listener in New York. Derek writes this. Dr. McGee has assisted me in a very challenging time in my life and in a very important point in my life. I've dealt with depression for many years, and the mornings are most challenging for me. Listening to the encouraging, word-grounded ministry of Through the Bible always reminds me that the joy of the Lord is indeed my strength. Dr. McGee's sense of humor is like medicine for my soul. Well, thanks for sharing with us, Derek. So, what's your story? What's God doing in your life as we study His Word together? Is there maybe a specific passage or lesson that's been meaningful to you? Well, why don't you tell us about it? You can email us at BibleBus@ttb.org or send a letter to Box 7100, Pasadena, California, 91109. If you listen in Canada, Box 25325, London, Ontario, N6C6B1 is where you need to write. And let's pray as we begin our study together. Heavenly Father, would you open our hearts and our minds as we listen? Would you speak to those who don't know you, and then draw them into a saving relationship with your Son, Jesus? It's in His precious name we pray. Amen. Here's Through the Bible with Dr. J. Vernon McGee.
Now, in chapters 29 and 30, you have what in Deuteronomy can be considered the Palestinian covenant. Dr. Chafer takes chapters 28 through 30 as the covenant. And the Scofield Reference Bible begins with chapter 29 and considers chapter 29 the introduction, and then takes it through the 30th chapter, verse 10. Now, in my notes, I take chapters 29 and through the 10 verses of chapter 30 as being the covenant. But very candidly, the covenant proper is chapter 30, the first 10 verses. But now this that is preliminary is very important, by the way, and the covenant is mentioned here in chapter 29. Now let me begin reading here. These are the words of the covenant which the Lord commanded Moses to make with the children of Israel in the land of Moab beside the covenant which he made with them in Horeb. Now, the covenant in Horeb was the Ten Commandments, of course, what we know as the Mosaic Law. Now, the covenant here that he's going to make with them relates to the land, and it's called the Palestinian Covenant. And it's right before they enter into the land. Now, verse 2, Moses called unto all Israel and said unto them, ye have seen all that the Lord did before your eyes in the land of Egypt unto Pharaoh and unto all his servants and unto all his land. Most of these people he's speaking to, of course, were children at the time. Some of them, I'm sure, teenagers, but they had been witness of these things. Now, verse 3, the great temptations which thine eyes have seen, the signs and those great miracles, yet the Lord hath not given you a heart to perceive, and eyes to see, and ears to hear unto this day. Isaiah had a great deal to say about that, and you'll find Paul over in the 11th chapter of the Epistle to the Romans, verse 8. He says, according as it is written, God hath given them the spirit of slumber, eyes that they should not see, and ears that they should not hear unto this day. Now, does it mean that God just turns them off? No, it means this, they're already off. God has to turn us on. And that is the place where we need to recognize that until God opens the eyes and the ears of men and women, they cannot hear the gospel. Now, don't misunderstand me. They can hear the words, but they cannot hear the gospel with understanding. I have had called to my attention an article. In fact, it's been sent to me from a friend and listener in Texas that appeared in a magazine back there that they put in their newspaper. And it has to do with a radio station that's across the border in Texas. And the writer of the article there speaks of the fact that it's a bunch of religious racketeers that are on the station. And then he puts me on the station and attempts to tell about my program there. And I'm of the opinion, of course, we're not even on that station. And I can't understand why a writer would be so inaccurate as that. But he does have a few facts, that is, that we are going through the Bible in 5 years. And he thinks that if you attempt to teach the Bible today, that you're running a religious racket. And my point has been, we actually have taken this up with a lawyer. And our point has been, because I don't want to sue or anything like that, but it's too bad that this man can't listen to the program and see what we're trying to do. And if he'd listen over a period of time, but again, you feel frustrated, suppose he did listen. He wouldn't understand. He just wouldn't be able to comprehend. He'd still, I think, come up with the same conclusion he has. Well, this fellow McGee that's teaching the Bible on the radio, he can't have anything but an ulterior motive in that. After all, the Bible is just being used as propaganda. He wouldn't believe it at all. But we wish he would listen in. Maybe the Spirit of God would open his eyes and his heart to see that we are presenting the Word of God today that is effective, that reaches in and touches the hearts of many folk. Now, God says that that's what he did for those people. He just left them as they were. Why? Because they had no purpose whatsoever to turn to him. They broke down all communication with the living and true God, and God therefore just left them in that state of unbelief. Verse 5. And I have led you 40 years in the wilderness, he says, and your clothes are not waxen old upon you, and thy shoe is not waxen old upon thy foot. Now imagine walking 40 years in the same pair of shoes, and they didn't wax old. And then he goes on to describe their journey that they had made through the wilderness, and that that should have opened their eyes. A great many people today say, oh, if God would only perform a miracle right before my eyes, I would believe. Well, these people saw him for 40 years, and they didn't believe. That's not the problem today. It's not for the want of evidence that men are unbelievers. They're unbelievers not because of the Bible. They're not unbelievers because of that which is outside. They're unbelievers because they are inside an unbeliever, and they are innately, and they're an enemy of God. They have no capacity for the things of God. What a picture God presents of the human heart, that it is desperately wicked, and none of us can actually conceive of how terrible it really is, and that the carnal mind is enmity against God. It's not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. And Paul wrote that after God had tested these people for about 1,200 to 1,500 years with the law. He says, so then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. What a picture of humanity. Now, that is the history that he gives here, which is preliminary to the covenant now. And so we have him giving here what will ultimately happen in that land before he gives the covenant, in which he makes it clear that he intends to bring them back into that land and bless them and the land. The land and the people go together. Actually, the whole Mosaic system is geared for that land, not only for the people, but for that land. That's important to see. Now, this is the condition of the land as it is today. And friends, here's one of the most remarkable prophecies that you probably have ever seen in Scripture. The Mount of Olives, even in our Lord's day, was covered with trees. It was a regular wooded area. It was the enemies that came in there, the Babylonians, the Greeks, the Romans, that cut out all the timber. Here in Southern California, where I live in Pasadena, right up against the mountains, a friend told me, and a very old man, he said, when I first came as a boy to California, I hunted up in these mountains. They were all covered with trees. Friends, they're bare today, no trees at all. Well, that was the way it was in that land, covered with trees, and they're gone today. The judgment of God, not only upon a people, but upon a land. Now, will you notice, verse 22, so that the generation to come of your children that shall rise up after you, and the stranger that shall come from a far land, shall say when they see the plagues of that land and the sicknesses which the Lord hath laid upon it, and that the whole land thereof is brimstone and salt and burning, that it is not sown nor beareth, nor any grass groweth therein, like the overthrow of Sodom and Gomorrah, Admon and Zeboiim, which the Lord overthrew in his anger and in his wrath, even all nations shall say, wherefore hath the Lord done thus unto this land? What meaneth the heat of this great anger? Then men shall say, because they have forsaken the covenant of the Lord God of their fathers, which he made with them when he brought them forth out of the land of Egypt. For they went and served other gods and worshipped them, gods whom they knew not, and whom he had not given unto them. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against this land to bring upon it all the curses that are written in this book. Now, I heard years ago the late Dr. George Gill tell about a trip that he made many years ago from Constantinople down to Baghdad by train. Actually, the train came down through Asia Minor and came down in that land. And late in the afternoon, they were leaving Jerusalem and dropping down into the Dead Sea area. And as they did, there was a very wealthy American standing out on the back vestibule of the train, and he made this statement. He said, I always heard this was the land of milk and honey. Why, I've never seen a land that is as bad as this. I've never seen anything like this. Why, this is the worst thing I've ever seen. I've never seen land like it. And Dr. Gill standing there, he says, you know, it's interesting what you've said. And he turned to this passage of Scripture. And he says, you know that the Bible says, the stranger that shall come from a far land shall say, when they see the plagues of the land and the sicknesses which the Lord hath laid upon it, they're going to say, what means all of this? They'll say, wherefore hath the Lord done thus under this land? What meaneth the heat of this great anger? Well, what's the explanation of the land being like that, and it once was a land of milk and honey? And Dr. Gill says, I'm going to say to you exactly what Moses said I would say to you 3,500 years ago. Then men shall say, because they've forsaken the covenant of the Lord God of their fathers, which he made with them when he brought them forth out of the land of Egypt. They went and served other gods, and the Lord rooted them out of their land in anger and in wrath and in great indignation and cast them into another land as it is this day. The secret things belong unto the Lord our God, but those things which are revealed belong unto us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of this law. Friends, God hadn't told us a whole lot of things, but there's certain things he's told us, and he sure told us about that land that's over there today, right now. They're trying to get water on it. Why, there those that say, well, what sort of a population could it take care of? And Dr. Loudermilk, that was over there for a while, he was an authority in agriculture. He said if this land could get water to it and agriculture could be revived in this land, he says it would easily take care of 15 to 25 millions of people. May I say to you, I traveled from Jericho up to Jerusalem. Then I went from Jerusalem down back to Jericho. Then I went from Jericho back up to Jerusalem. I want to say to you, friends, you're bound to say, what meaneth all a judgment on a land of milk and honey? They are out of that land because God said you go into it and live in it on condition. But does that mean now that they'll not go back to it? Does that mean that they fail? No, God made the Palestinian covenant with these people, and here it is. Will you listen to it now? Chapter 30, verse 1, and this is an unconditional covenant. There are no ifs here or perhapses here. Listen to this. And it shall come to pass, when all these things are come upon thee, the blessing and the curse, which I have set before thee, and thou shalt call them to mind among all the nations, whither the Lord thy God hath driven thee, and shall return unto the Lord thy God, shall obey his voice, according to all that I command thee this day, thou and thy children with all thine heart, with all thy soul, that then the Lord thy God will turn thy captivity, have compassion upon thee, and will return and gather thee from all the nations whither the Lord thy God hath scattered thee. Now this is an unconditional promise of future blessing, and I want you to notice several things that he says here. There are seven great promises that God makes here, are statements that he makes that are unconditional. The nation shall be plucked off of the land for its unfaithfulness. That's quite obvious here. That took place. And there will be a future repentance of Israel. They are going to come back to God. Now, somebody says, well, it's on the basis of their obedience, is it not? No, my friend, they were dispersed because of disobedience, so in their return they will be obedient. But this is the order of grace, not law. They are not returned because they are obedient, but they are obedient because of their return. God will bring them back to the land. The regathering of Israel into her own land is the theme, I think, of at least 12 major prophecies in the Old Testament. We're not dealing with those others today, only as we come to them, and we'll call attention when we do. Now, there's a third great statement made here. Their Messiah will return. Notice that. This is very important. And this is the first mention of the return of Christ to the earth that's recorded in Scripture. Now, when we get to the book of Jude, we'll find out Enoch mentioned it, that he was coming back. But that was not recorded in the Old Testament. Verse 3, that then the Lord thy God will turn thy captivity, have compassion on thee, and will return and gather thee from all the nations, whither the Lord thy God hath scattered thee. That's a remarkable prophecy, you see, and will yet be fulfilled. And it was not until then that the land will be blessed, and there'll be peace in the land. The fourth statement God made is, Israel will be restored to the land. And will you notice that? The Lord thy God will bring thee into the land which thy fathers possessed, and thou shalt possess it, and he will do thee good and multiply thee above thy fathers. That's an unconditional promise of God that rests on no if on their part. God says, in the future, he brings them back into that land. Now notice the sixth thing that's mentioned here, and that is Israel's enemies will be judged. Verse 7, and the Lord thy God will put all these curses upon thine enemies, and on them that hate thee, which persecuted thee. And thou shalt return and obey the voice of the Lord. You see, they'll return and then obey the voice of the Lord. That's the order of grace, friend. There's no condition here. And do all his commandments, which I command thee this day. Well, somebody says, couldn't the return today actually be that? Could be, but we don't know it, friends. So let's not be dogmatic where we don't know. Now, notice the seventh wonderful thing he says, the nation will then receive her full blessing. Notice this, and the Lord thy God will make thee plenteous in every work of thine hand, in the fruit of the body, and in the fruit of thy cattle, in the fruit of thy land, for good. For the Lord will again rejoice over thee for good, as he rejoiced over thy fathers. If thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to keep his commandments and his statutes, which are written in this book of the law, and if thou return to the Lord God with all thine heart, with all thy soul. Now, may I say to you, this is the condition on which they occupy the land today, is obedience to God. There'll be no blessing for them in that land unless they obey God. But when God returns them, he's made a covenant that he will return them someday, and it rests upon no ifs, ands, or perhapses. This is without doubt one of the most remarkable that we have in the entire Word of God. Now, he comes back, and because of this covenant, and you see, they are yet to go through two more dispersions for the land. They'll be returned one time. The third one has not taken place yet, even in our day. Now, he goes on to say in verse 11, for this commandment, which I command thee this day, it's not hidden from thee, neither is it far off. It's not in heaven that thou shouldst say, who shall go up for us to heaven and bring it unto us, that we may hear it and do it. Neither is it beyond the sea, that thou shouldst say, who shall go over the sea for us and bring it unto us, that we may hear it and do it. You see that they can plead no excuse that they do not know it. God has brought it right to them. They can know it. And there is a responsibility to live in a land today where you can hear the gospel. And my friend, you don't have to go to heaven to get salvation. You don't have to cross the ocean to get it. May I say to you, it's right near you. It's as near you as your radio. It's near you as a preacher or a Christian who will give out the Word of God today. And you're responsible. You are responsible. That's where your free will comes in, friend. You're responsible. My business is to get it out today. And I try to get it right up to your eardrum. That's as far as I can go. From then on, it's up to you. It's not up to me at all. But it's wonderful to be able to bring the Word of God today. What a marvelous passage this is. We'll leave off right there and pick right up there next time. May God richly bless you, my beloved.
As we break for the weekend, you don't have to take a break from God's Word. We got some great Bible study materials at ttb.org. And remember, you can always call us at 1-800-65-BIBLE if we can help you find something specific. And then be sure to join me for Dr. McGee's Sunday sermon, Can a Christian Lose His Salvation? It's available online, on our app, or on your local radio station. And be sure to come back here next time for another great study in Deuteronomy. I'm Steve Schwetz. I'll see you then.
Jesus made it home. Unto Him I owe. Sin hath left the crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Our journey on the Bible bus today is supported by the prayers and gifts of fellow passengers as we travel through the Bible.